Hey guys, how's it going? Dr. Spin. So the explicit goal, one of the explicit goals of my channel, my video blog, is to try to bring to light bands and that you may not have heard before, off-center, maybe things out of the ordinary. And that may be newer bands that are maybe not so visible. But also, I like to bring up stuff from maybe the past that are forgotten gems that maybe you have not heard of or maybe have forgotten about. And for most people, I think that you probably will not have heard of this next album, but that's a shame because it's a great one. Okay, this one is an album that was released in 2001 by a Fort Worth band called Sugarbomb, and the album's called Bully. Now, I discovered Bully through Amazon recommendations of all things. You know, I was kind of following this power pop line of thinking, and you know, you back then, I think the algorithm for Amazon was a little bit different. These days, Amazon just kind of shows you stuff that was released around the same time. But back then, it seemed like to me that I was able to actually find things that were more similar but weren't the exact same thing. So I had kind of run aground of a lot of power pop music that I've been listening to, but this one came up, and Sugarbomb came out at the time in 2003. When the record companies had kind of lost their ability to control the narrative of what was coming out. So that made it more difficult for independent and you know, up-and-coming bands to find their way to kind of make it big. One of the ways in which you could do that back then was perhaps get your song on a movie or a TV show. And Sugarbomb was able to do that. They had a low-key hit with a song called Hello, which ended up being on National Lampoon's Van Wilder. Now, of course, I don't doubt that anybody who saw that movie, you know, listened to the song in the background of whether at this party or something, and go, man, I like that song. I'm going to go find out who it is and buy that album. But back then, it was a big deal, an aspiration to have your music on a movie or a TV show. So, Sugarbomb did have a little bit of visibility due to the appearance of the song Hello in Van Wilder. Song, but I'll also kind of put out there that I don't even know if it's the best song on this album. The overall album has a really great playful energy that Hello clearly has, but the overall quality of the songs is extremely high, and the ebullient feel of the album makes it a pretty infectious listen throughout. Now, yeah, you'll look at it and listen to it a little bit, and so yeah, it kind of has a little bit of a hokey 90s feel. And I think that's a point that you could make only now in retrospect. But I will argue that it actually boils down some of the best things about 90s power pop music and puts it in a pretty compelling distillation of what was great about 90s power pop when it was happening. In fact, you know, Jellyfish in the mid-90s was very good about being able to look at a time period and distill what was awesome about pop music in that time and then write a song in that style. And I think that you could almost say that Sugarbomb, in a way, kind of did that for the 90s. I don't think it was intentional, but it's kind of the overall effect. And even though they kind of slapped in this kind of, every now and then, the little Blink-182 white boy rap sections of their songs, as was the style then, very commonly, they also have a very theatric and cinematic aspect to their music that almost aligns them with Queen. And it doesn't hurt that all five guys in the band can sing really well, and they can stack those harmonies in a way that, you know, you really can't think of many other bands that use harmonies like that. And I think also, if you kind of squint your eyes and listen to some of this music, it's not too hard to kind of imagine what Freddie Mercury would sound like singing them. Not to say that Les Farrington sounds like Freddie Mercury, and I don't think he's trying to. Which is probably smart to his credit. But I also think it's kind of, I can imagine Freddie Mercury singing many of these songs, and along with the stacked vocals, it kind of definitely harkens back to some of the more radio-friendly aspects of Queen's music. And one of the big sells on the album is Sugarbomb's really infectious melodic sense. I mean, they've got melodies on this album that will stick, and they're extremely clever, and they're extremely well thought out. There are many things that you can do to make a melody memorable, and I think that Sugarbomb kind of does all of them at one point in time or another on Bully.
How can I forget the situation? Spitting out the words without hesitation. Never take a moment to breathe. Overworking my grief with my heart on my roller sleeve.
That song Motormouth is just kind of off in the middle of the album, and it's got a great melody to it, and that's the standard for the album throughout it. But all those great melodies will carry you very, very far, in my opinion. But what's really the icing on the cake is their fabulous lyrics on this album. They are, the Sugarbomb's lyrics are really, really great on this album. The narrative is super relatable. Sugarbomb addresses issues that I think that are pretty fundamental to most people, and in a way that's like, you know, almost conversational. You know, it feels like, to me, they're able to say all the things that you wish you would have been able to say to that guy or that girl when you were in sixth grade and you first experienced those things, you know. And I'm not trying to say that the lyrics are infantile or adolescent, but far to the contrary, it just feels like they're so fundamental to most people's experiences that, you know, if you're a teenager, it's something that you can sink your fingers into. And even if you're 35 years old or 40 years old, you can listen to these songs and go, yeah, I've experienced that somewhere along the line. Or maybe I'm experiencing that. You're experiencing that now. Who knows? They're not high-minded. They're not overly, you know, intellectual by any means. But they're also not pandering. They're very direct and very street level, you know, in their register. And the title track to this album, Bully, is a prime example. And first of all, the title track is called Bully. Never in the song do they actually say the word bully. You know, they dance around that term a lot. Bully's pretty anthemic. I mean, you want to raise your hand in the air and pump your fist a little bit to that one. And one of the reasons why it's so effective is its elegant use of dynamics. I mean, it's cruising along at the beginning with that very smooth driving guitar lick, and then just roars into the chorus every time he starts getting defiant. Pick on somebody your own size. It cranks it up, and the wall of guitars, that 90 wall of guitars, shows up. Amazing. Smart songwriting. And effective. And Bully also kind of captures something about the album, I think, that shows up in the lyrics as you examine them closer. This kind of has a belligerent undertone, you know. On the one hand, the music for this album is kind of very happy. It's kind of party music. And it has a little bit of a defiant tone to it. And if you look even closer, there's a lot of songs on here that are about heartbreak, about rejection, about loneliness. And from a certain perspective, if you look at that aspect of it too closely, it can almost come off as being maybe a little bit depressing, which is another juxtaposition. You know, you have this kind of music that you'd be playing at a frat party almost. And then, you know, underneath it, that you're just, you know, there's this undercurrent of sorrow to it. But look even closer. If you look even closer, every time it seems like the sadness and the darkness will overwhelm the narrative on this album, on these songs, he turns it and takes a stand against the feelings that he has and says, you know, I choose not to feel that way. You know, I it's a thing I'm not going to do. I'm not going to be succumb to sadness and loneliness, and I'm not going to allow it to overwhelm me. And this album came to me at a time where I really kind of need to hear that. You know, I had just kind of had my own loss. I was dealing with trying to figure out how to be by myself and what it meant to, and I was just kind of figuring out how to turn things around and stand on my own. And when this album showed up, it spoke to me in a way that, that I needed to hear. So again, it connects with me very personally too on that regard. So for me, on top of everything else, on top of being a great album and a well-written album with great lyrics, I really connected with it in a way that still resonates with me to this day. So clearly, I think that Sugarbomb's Bully is a great album. It's one that people should check out, and it's criminally overlooked, I think. In my opinion, probably a power pop classic. All right, that's all I got for you guys this week. Thanks a lot for people who have kind of kept it going and have been talking to me about things. Bully came up because a good friend of mine who watches the videos kind of brought it to my attention, and we had a discussion about it. So it's something I've wanted to cover for a long time. And at the same time I got Sugarbomb, there was another album I got. I kind of consider this its sister album, Tsar's self-titled album. And I may be covering that one soon because I feel like I can't cover one without talking about the other. So we'll keep our eyes open for that one. But until then, I'll catch you guys on the flip side.